Evening. I'd like to call to order the Lyft Littleton Invest for tomorrow, Urban Renewal Authority Board meeting tonight. Glad to see everybody here tonight. And I'm Justin Hay, the Chair of the Board, and would like to recognize our board members that are in attendance here tonight. Our Gary Thompson and LaDonna Jurgensen, Jim Collins, Ryan Toole, Kyle Schlachter, Craig O'Rourke. And we also have Bruce Stallman, our City Council Liaison, as well as Jim Reese, our Executive Director, is here tonight. And Corey Hoffman, our legal rep, is here as well tonight. So let's go ahead and jump on into our agenda for this evening. First is the review and approval of the minutes. And maybe before we jump into that process, I do have a question. After we review and approve, if there's any amendments that come across on the minutes that may have some adjustments that we need to make, can we ever come back after mm-hmm. the approval mm-hmm. and make an amendment if possible?
You could, but if you know that there are proposed amendments, I think the better practice is to delay them to after the public comments so you're not going back and doing it twice.
Okay. Well, why don't we go through the February 12th video recording, because that has been posted. And if there's any questions or if we've had any outlined items on that, and I know that, are we going through the process, Jim, of having the city clerk serve that on
no,
the website?
I thought I sent you a note earlier this week and to Corey that they will not do that, because basically what the city clerk is doing is certifying that it is an account of the meeting, and they don't come to our meeting, so they can't really verify it. So basically we have to pretty much self-certify that you've seen them and you've yep. agreed that those are the, you know, there's nothing wrong with the video recording, and
right.
that's really what you're saying, is it?
And I want to just clarify that. So the fact that we're not going that route, and we are, as a board, approving and certifying the video recording. So if we can tonight, I'd like to do that on the February 12th recording and go through that. LaDonna?
I could not download it.
Okay.
Or get it to play, I guess, whatever. Mm-hmm. I got an unapproved source or some message like that. But and I was going to try it from my office, and I didn't have time to do that. But does anybody know who you would talk to? Is there somebody at the
city?
Well,
our tech support, correct? Well, Matt used to do that, upload those to the website. So what we would probably do is need to either have text.
Oh, no, Matt doesn't.
Well, Kyle said he had to download
it. I watched the video. It was there.
Yeah, it was there. It's fine. I watched it, too.
I did the same. But yeah. So is it?
The city does that. We don't have anything to
right.
do with it.
It just streams, yeah. So, yeah. So it exists. It exists.
Yeah, if you go to the website right now, it's on a link, okay. and you click it, and it opens up your
browser. You have to go back a month in the calendar and click on that, but it's doable.
Since it exists, and I move it be approved.
I'll second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Okay. Any objection to the motion? Okay. Well, the motion to approve the February 12th video recording has been made and approved. So on the item of the March 12th written minutes, I understand there's some discrepancy there on the public side that we received, and that what we could do is just kind of like we did with the February, allow public comment to relay what the discrepancies were in the minutes, and if we have as a board any discrepancies and what was heard and what was actually written down, let's hear them tonight, and then we can delay that for our next approval.
Well, you can.
So I motion to table the approval of the minutes till after public appearance.
Second. Okay. Motion's made. Any discussion or? Okay, well, the motion's been made, no objection, so the motion passes to push that to the next meeting in May. All right, next item on the agenda is the announcements. Any announcements tonight?
I don't have any, unless you do.
I don't have any. I think we can, bring up some things here later in the agenda, but anybody have announcements tonight? All right, moving on. Public appearances. I think most of you know the drill here in the room. Let's do 4 minutes of speaker. Please step to the podium and identify yourselves, and we'll go from there.
Is there a microphone at the podium?
Yeah, is there a mic up there? If not, maybe if there's an extra, or maybe you can borrow one of these. They're wireless, you can throw them up there.
That chair right there.
There you go. Okay. Why don't you
just use this one?
Why don't you just step right here?
Hi, Lyft Board. My name is Pam Chadbourne. I live at Crestline in Nevada, across from the Santa Fe Urban Renewal Area. I have a couple of things, three things. First of all, I delivered mail to you. It's got corrections for at least two of the public speakers from last meeting. And they're written comments that the speakers read from, and they know that the proposed or draft minutes for March 12th in the package are not correct. I'm just going to point out to you the first sentence, which says that one of them stated they lived in Columbine Square. So nobody lives in Columbine Square. These are kind of major inaccuracies that I think go to the credibility of the minutes. I think you should postpone. Well, I think you voted to postpone, and I'd like you to consider these corrections and maybe a couple others if we can get some written versions to at least the public appearances for those written minutes. I also wanted to talk about the forms that you're going to review tonight, which I know seems deadly dull. However, I've worked on proposals, reviewing proposals, government proposals, spending taxpayer money for projects that are complex, and once they are launched into space, you can't go back and get them and repair them. And that's like a city. Once you build stuff, you're really committed to it for decades. So I encourage you to spend time and thought and effort on these forms because they're vital. Some issues are that all of the applicants have to be treated equally, so the materials that you offer them and the guidance you give all of them have to be the same. And then when you get it in, you need enough not just to evaluate how good they are, but also how bad they are, their strengths and their weaknesses. And the other thing that I'm looking for here, which maybe you'll discuss in executive session, is what tools, methods, procedures you're going to use to evaluate these proposals. Again, I know in-house what we had were huge amounts of data, which we used to evaluate the material that came in. And I mean, I'm quite sure that you can't really finalize the forms until you know that your evaluation criteria line up and make sure that all the stuff that you need to evaluate, the strengths and weaknesses in your evaluation process are requested in the forms. So I want to thank undertaking this. It's hard, I know, but on the riverfront, in the Riverfront Authority, Tom Christopite talked to us, and he said 4 months after they signed the contract with Ryder Corp, they went up to Boulder to a design firm, a nationally recognized one, and asked him about it. And their conclusion was that there was not the market in this area to support Riverfront. And of course, they were right. And that was 4 months after the contract was signed. Please, please have something in your process to get second opinions and evaluations, and to have strong evaluation for market and all these other aspects. In your evaluation, maybe you don't even need the second opinion to get there, but we've made this mistake before. It costs us millions of dollars. It costs the bondholders millions. It costs Ryder millions. So this is really important what you're doing. I thank you for it. I know that it's hard, and I want to acknowledge you and urge you to take care and effort, and I really appreciate it. We all will. Thanks.
Thanks, Pam.
I'm Carol Brezak. Just a quick note. I watch these meetings at home regularly. If you don't use your microphone, just as Jim did a little earlier, he's back here, the microphone's there, they don't hear it at home. So for those of us in the room and for those of us that watch at home, I'm here tonight because I I can't get good audio at home. So please use your microphone so that all of us can hear the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
My name is Linda Knufinking. I'm going to stir the pot just a little bit. I just wanted to address, and I'm sure Mr. Hoffman is going to address the arbitration proceedings between Arapahoe County and the city of Littleton, and I just wanted to read a little bit of information from that, I don't know what they call it, I think they call it something like arbitration order. It says here, and this is regard to, they reviewed the plans and all of the documentation from the city, and such, this is what they say, quote, and this is on the second page, the first, second, third paragraph, and it says, quote, as such, the panel finds that the reports presented and approved are woefully inadequate to place the petitioner, which is Arapahoe County, comma, or anyone else for that matter, comma, on notice of its presumed obligations under the approved plans. That being said, the panel is equally cognizant that it is the incumbent on the petitioner, the prerequisite to avail itself of the procedures and remedies set forth in the statute. So the decision was more procedural, and it really did say that you have to step up your reports that you present to the county so they can make heads or tails out of them. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Anyone else tonight? Okay. So that closes our public appearances for this evening. Next item on our agenda tonight is the financial report. And Jim, would you like to walk through our monthly financial statement for March?
Sure. Sure, excuse me. So maybe can we start with the check register, because it's kind of, it gives you a little bit more explanation. Do that first. So for the month, we had five checks written. One was for R&R Engineering for the change order work on the legal descriptions. There may be more charges to that. And the next one was for CIG for communications work, managing the website, Matt's time taking our minutes, that type of thing. My time. And the city of Littleton printing costs for our packets, as well as the webinar fee that a couple of you went to, I think. Did you have it at your office, Justin? Is that what you did? Or?
Yeah, Gary and I attended the webinar, yep.
No, I mean, that little packet that was...
Yeah, CDFA.
That came in after your...
Oh, great.
Yeah, I thought it was very handy.
That's great. I'll have to look through it. Yeah. Great, thank you.
That was your seminar list, yeah. And then finally, legal services for the month of February. So a total distributions of $14,696.43. And then if you go over to the next page with the monthly financial statement, you'll see that we've spent $25,111.36 so far this year in our budget.
Jim, is there a fee for the video recording of our meetings?
No. Okay. They post all that for us. Yeah, the city charges us for printing, but that's pretty nominal.
Okay. Well, any questions? Do I have a motion to approve the March financial statement?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Or objection? Okay, motion is passed.
Thank you.
Next item is our check register for and through March 31st. That was pretty much
went through it.
Okay, we
kind of have to do them both together. It's kind of hard not to.
They're both separated out, so I always go to the next item. Okay, well, they're both approved per our motion and second there. So, okay, we'll move on to Jim, committee reports, please.
Okay, so I guess I'm first. Okay, a couple of things. Wanted to announce that Matt Whittern from CIG, who's done all our public relations work for the last year, was very instrumental in all the public hearings that we had for the four urban renewal plans, has moved on. He's taken a job with the Denver Water Department. So tonight, we have Angela Shelbourne, who's going to be taking over Matt's functions. And feel free later if we want to talk about what CIG does, that Angela's here to talk about it. And do you want to say a few things and give you a little background or anything?
My name is Angela Shelbourne. I've been with CIG for the last year. Prior to that, I was with RTD working on fast tracks for 10 years. So been around the city for quite a while and glad to meet you all. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to address them.
Great. Well, welcome, Angela.
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you all that helped me get the lift audit exemption finished. I ran around here like a crazy person for a day, but we got it in and submitted, so I think we're taken care of there. And I've heard nothing, so I guess that's good news. Hopefully they accepted it as an exemption, which they should. Other news, the LIFT loan that we asked City Council to approve, the second draw of $50,000, that was approved on March 17th, so now we are authorized up to $100,000. And you've seen on our financial report, we have not spent all that, thank goodness. Santa Fe plan amendment at the same meeting. That was interesting. Council did take out five parcels. There were four property owners that requested that their property be removed from the Santa Fe plan. And we had the one parcel that was owned by the city of Englewood, which required the county commissioners to approve and agree to take that parcel out. And rather than go through that route, we decided just it was less than I think it was like a tenth of an acre. It's very, very small. It's like a lift station. So we decided to ask council to remove that one as well. Additionally, that night, you remember we had asked them to amend the plan, and then we came back and said, no, we'd rather you didn't amend the plan. So council did vote the amendment down, is basically how it went. So it wasn't like they didn't consider it. They did consider it, but they voted no. Got that right, didn't I? Okay. As far as potential development projects, most of everything is really kind of on the Enzer property parcels with a potential developer on that is really kind of on hold until this agricultural land issue is settled, because that's primarily where the agricultural land is located. So really hasn't been any activity on that recently. And Corey can talk a little bit about that whole situation with the agricultural land. The villages of Bellevue, they are available, by the way. I know I polled you all, and I think Jim was the only one that couldn't make it on the 7th for to change our board meeting, if you would consider that. And the developers are willing to come in and do that. They can make that date. So we can schedule that in if we can somehow get that published, that our next meeting will be on the 7th rather than the 14th.
Okay.
So we should have somebody here to talk about that. Hopefully they'll have a lot more detail than what you've seen so far. And then finally, this afternoon, as a matter of fact, Ryan, Kyle, and Craig, we sat down and did the Urban Renewal 101. So they've had a little bit of orientation and kind of gave them what we've been doing for the last year and how we got to where we are today. So they know everything, that you know now.
Probably more.
And that's all I've got.
Okay.
I have a question. This is probably a foolish question, but so in the council in March removed five parcels from, why does that not require then a vote of the everyone in Littleton?
Councilor.
Because under the language of the ballot question, it was not a question that affected any of the things that the ballot that triggers the ballot question. So it didn't affect TIF. It didn't affect any of the, and it was not a substantial modification. The council made a finding effectively in the resolution removing the properties that it wasn't a substantial modification within the meaning of the statute, and it didn't trigger the voter approval under the language of the ballot question.
Okay.
I have a question on the developers for the Columbine Square parcel. Is that typical that they would come in and make a, as far as I know, they haven't really given us any information as far as who the owners are, who the developer is, anything. As what we're reviewing tonight, the financial information, is that typical that they would come in and make a presentation? And I guess it's basically the concept before they give us any other information?
Yeah, I think it's important that they come in and tell you what they're planning to do, what their project is. You get to ask them questions, and then they can go back. I'm sorry, Carol, I have to do this. I have a habit of leaning back. So they can come in, you can ask them questions, and ask them to provide additional information and, of course, complete our requirements for our submittal. So I think it's important to do it. And, yeah, you know, it can go on simultaneously. You're not going to be asked to approve it that night.
Oh, I know we're not going to be asked to approve it, but it just seems like we're getting the fluff and not getting any of the substantive information.
You'll get both.
Well, not next month, I assume.
You know, I'm going to push them as much as I can to get as much information as possible, yes.
Okay.
Where are they in the process with the city? Have they submitted site plan? Have they begun any of the, you know, planning process, entitlement, anything with the city at this point, or?
I don't believe they have at this point.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, to maybe LaDonna's point, you know, a lot of those items, obviously, in the pecking order, I know we talk about concurrency. You know, this process is concurrent and should mm-hmm. be, and we want to cultivate the right group to come in and do a great project here for what we're on a board for, to take it through our filters. But at the same time, it'd be great to understand, you know, if we're in alignment in their presentation or premature, if they haven't started any city process or any initial processing there, that I don't know either. I'm not privy to that at this point in time, but if we're going to do some concurrency, even if they've engaged the city to a certain level or haven't, it'd be good to understand that as we kind of move through that process with them and getting familiar and making sure that it makes sense for the community as a whole and with the city, et cetera. So it'd be great to understand where they're at. And I don't know, Bruce, you know, if you have anything from your standpoint of what you've seen or where they're at.
Do you want to respond first? Or?
Well, my thought on that was, you know, we would ask them to make that part of their presentation to explain where they are in the development yes. review process. Mm-hmm.
My sense is, and I don't know this definitively, I do not believe they have filed a formal plan. I don't believe there's any schedule for a planning commission, planning board review. Certainly there's nothing on our agenda yet that I'm aware of from a land use rezoning question perspective, let alone anything that would have to do with the urban renewal piece. I think they probably have engaged at some level with the planning staff or community development staff. But that would be normal from the standpoint of working through technical issues in terms of whatever plan they're trying to develop. I'm making an assumption.
Okay.
So, because since it's fenced off and since they came in last month and showed you guys some renderings and so forth and so on, I know I'm assuming it's quite probable they spent a lot of time and some money thinking about it. Wouldn't make sense to not engage community development to sort out issues.
I think maybe just redefining our role and what we're absorbing from them. You know, we're not the planning board. We're not city staff. So, you know, we're simply here to mm-hmm. kind of do all, you know, take our role to the end. So I think we need to make sure that if that does, that presentation does happen, which it sounds like, you know, we're moving towards that on the 7th, that we all collectively feel good about, you know, what we're going to receive and what we're kind of commenting on and discussing as part of that project and presentation, that we don't start crossing outside of, you know, all of us becoming, you know, planners and other things there. So I think that we just need to be cognizant of that and check ourselves in that process.
You know, and as a cross-check, I'll be happy to contact planning and find out where they are.
That'd be great.
I was going to suggest it might make sense to contact the city manager and just sort of maybe put an email together lining out the process over a period of time and when people could expect what, just so that there's something, a roadmap, I guess. And I'm sure he can make that happen or provide it and so forth.
Okay. Will do.
Yeah, overall, I'm looking forward to, you know, hearing about their project and seeing where they're going. So outside of that, I mean, that's what we're trying to do is get a deal going here. So, you know, on that end, it's good. But, yeah, it'd be great to sink in with the other workings of the city.
So. Okay. We'll do that.
Anything else?
I don't
Jim,
know.
On your end? Okay. Corey?
Good evening. A couple of items. First of all, if the board is inclined to hear from the developer on May 7th, I'd recommend making the motion tonight to change the May meeting to that May 7th date to trigger, at some point, to trigger the notices going out and doing it in this public process so that everyone's aware that the meeting is in fact going to be moved, if that's the board's prerogative. Secondly, regarding the arbitration proceedings that both the city and Lyft were party to, under the urban renewal law, the determination by the arbitrators was very limited. The proceeding filed by Arapahoe County under the statute, the only thing they could contest was whether the impact reports that were prepared as part of the urban renewal plan were adequate. That was the purpose of the arbitration. In order to make the find, in order to kind of tee up the issue for the arbitrators, they had to show not only that the impact reports were inadequate, but that it didn't adequately, that the county services were adversely impacted. The presentation made by Arapahoe County at the city council meeting never said that there was an adverse impact on county services. Instead, they said essentially, we can't evaluate it because we didn't get enough information. So the excerpt from the order that was read to you earlier is correct. What the arbitration panel said is, while we think this was inadequate, essentially, the county did not meet its burden of showing that the urban renewal plan adoption was going to create a negative impact on the services provided by Arapahoe County. And so the arbitration panel found in favor of the city and in favor of Lyft and against Arapahoe County on all four of the Arapahoe County's appeals because Arapahoe County never said there was going to be a negative impact on services. So what that means, the effect of that, is that the plans are in place. With the city and Lyft winning in the arbitration proceeding, the four urban renewal plans are in place. What is still pending is Arapahoe County's contesting whether the city can include agricultural land within the Santa Fe urban renewal plan area. That is litigation that is in the Arapahoe County District Court, still pending with a September trial date. And we have a fundamental disagreement on what the statute says. What we are waiting on right now is a final legal description of the Santa Fe urban renewal area, including all of the parcels that were approved by council as part of the urban renewal area, including the parcels that are the ag land. And then there is two ultimate legal questions that are going to be decided in that case. One is whether there is a percentage of urban level development both within the urban renewal area and adjacent to the urban renewal area within the meaning of the statute that would allow agricultural land to be included, and Arapahoe County and the city have a fundamental disagreement on how the statute is written and whether one element of the statute has to be met or several. And so we are trying with Arapahoe County to get facts that are not in dispute in front of the court so we can have the court make a decision as a matter of law. That is a very long-winded way of saying the city is still in litigation with Arapahoe County about the inclusion of ag land in Santa Fe. That is the only pending issue related to the adoption of the urban renewal plans. The county had initially filed an objection to the Columbine Square urban renewal plan amendment, and then it subsequently withdrew that objection. So the only remaining litigation is between the city and Arapahoe County related to the inclusion of agricultural land.
So the September date is the hearing, and is it projected to go beyond that, or is that?
There could certainly be an appeal. That would take it beyond that.
Yeah.
My hope is that we never get to a trial. My hope is that we can do this on what's called summary judgment, which is if there are no facts in dispute, the court can make a decision on the law. And my hope is that we can agree with the county, even on what we disagree about, and then put that in front of the court and have the court make some legal determination so we don't have to go through a trial process. That's my hope. And we have been meeting with Arapahoe County. We had hoped to have the legal description completed to meet with them actually tomorrow. That meeting has been postponed because the legal is not final. But we are hoping to meet with them and again get these issues resolved so we know what we disagree about, and then we can put that in front of the court.
I have a question that's kind of unrelated, but the parties to this litigation are the city and the county, correct? So why does Lyft pay the legal fees?
The legal fees that are in your packet are the legal fees from the arbitration.
Okay.
Jim and Justin and I actually had a discussion about that today, and I need to coordinate with the city, but the city and Lyft were parties to the arbitration. And so the legal fees for February reflect the arbitration proceeding and splitting those costs.
So we're actually paying half of the arbitration.
Okay. And none of the litigation.
That's what I need to check with the city. But the city, Lyft is not a party to the litigation, so only the city is.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
And then the only other thing I would point out is that the legislature may, in the next month or so, be looking at urban renewal. It's our understanding that the last month or so of the session, that issue is going to be a big part of the discussions down at the Capitol. So you may want to pay attention to that.
Actually, following up on that, I had a meeting today with Downtown Colorado, Inc. Phone conversation. But anyhow, apparently that legislation, for the Speaker of the House, will be introducing that legislation either tomorrow or Monday at the latest. So, because it's running, like Corey said, they're running out of time. But it's an understanding that that's where it will be introduced.
Do we have an idea of what the issues are or what the legislation will address?
Well, you know, it's very similar to what they, almost identical to what they did last year. The same thing is true. They want representation on the renewal board. They've tweaked that a little bit this year to include other special districts, not just the county. So they want there'll be more of you if it passes. But the biggest killer of the whole thing is how they want to split the tax increments. And so basically the deal the county is offering is that you can negotiate what that will be with all the taxing entities. But bottom line, if you don't come into an agreement, then there's a formula that kicks in that basically says the taxing entities will put into it the same percentage of property tax as a municipality will put in sales tax. Well, as you guys probably can surmise, in a retail project, that's a huge difference. I mean, ones I've done, sales tax runs like three times what property tax runs.
Okay.
So we don't really know. I mean, CML did that parallel bill that was already submitted, last 2 months ago. It was really early in the session. And that one was basically allowing the county to put a seat at the table, a member on the board. And then there was a clarification that really is already covered in the statute that really requires any money left over after a project is implemented, all the debt service and obligations are met, has to be gone back to the taxing entities on a pro rata basis. That's really already in it, but they've clarified it. So that's what the CML bill says. And that got as far as the Senate, I believe, and is waiting for a second reading, and they've put it on hold, basically.
Thank you.
When you guys, just to go back to the Bellevue issue, when you guys do the May 7th agenda, if you can put them at the end, if there's any other business, because again, per the presentations last month, I'll have to recuse myself from sitting in on that portion of the meeting, given we'll, again, be, if we end up having to hear a rezone on it, it'll be a, what's, again, referred to as a quasi-judicial process.
Okay.
So,
okay.
Thanks.
Yeah, we can do that.
And you can leave early then?
That's really what they're trying to do.
A tragic consequence of the situation, yes, indeed.
Okay. Anything else, Jim, Corey? And I think on before we leave that item, I want to make, just on Corey's suggestion, a motion to move the meeting to May 7th so we can get that on the agenda and everything appropriately.
And at 7 p.m.?
7 p.m., May 7th. Yeah, same place, right here. And
Jim is the only person that cannot attend.
But I understand everybody. Okay. So do we have a motion?
I so move.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Any objection? Okay. The motion passes to move the meeting to May 7th at 7 p.m. Okay, on to unfinished business. The first item is the revisions to the development proposal application from March 12th, from our last meeting. And I will note that we have had this, at, I don't know, maybe three, four of the past meetings. So we have been, going through filters on this and working through to make sure that we, cross all the T's and dot the I's. And, Jim, kind of like we've done in the last few board meetings here, would you like to walk through some of the revisions and where we are today, so we can hopefully get across the finish line on this one.
So I know the, and I sent you both the red line, or in my case, the blue line, and a clean version. And the main change, and you'll see a lot of blue on this, but most of it was changing the names referenced, because throughout the document, we referenced LIFT, we referenced the authority, sometimes we even spelled it all the way out. So I've changed everything that has anything to do with this body to LIFT. So that was one of the major corrections there. So you see a lot of that throughout this entire document. The other thing on page one, I'll draw your attention to the paragraph in the middle there under background. The board asked that I include a paragraph in there to explain what's now required to approve an urban renewal plan because of issue 300. And so I added that language in there, and a lot of it I copied straight out of the issue. So, and let's see, toward the back. So on the red line copy, page 7, under requirements for projects that are not within existing urban renewal areas, board members wanted that explained a little bit further as to how the process really would work. So I added a lot of language in there about what the Planning Commission's responsibility would be as far as the compliance with the comprehensive plan, then the notification requirements for the public as well as the county and the impact report. And then again, I reiterated the part about the if council were to adopt the plans, that they would have to be ratified.
Okay.
And I don't know if anybody had any more questions on that. You also asked that Corey take a look at it, and I know Corey's, I don't know if he had a chance or not, Corey.
I did.
Did you see anything you thought we needed to add?
I didn't, but I guess the one thing I would disagree with in a very general sense is I don't think all projects are the same. And so while this is a starting point in terms of format and the information I think is accurate, I would suggest that there will be ultimately an element of flexibility depending on the nature of the project, and there may be different things that the LIFT board may want to see. So this is intended, I would suggest, to be a template, but not a limiting template.
Do we have terminology that speaks to that in this application? I mean, if this is an application, it's not, you know, I guess it's not a public document, if you will. It's just, it's basically parameters. And is there flexibility for us there, I mean, within the parameters that we have, to adapt it to the specific project? I guess just to clarify that, that's what I've seen in here, and that's what we've kind of been talking through. I just want to reiterate that and clarify that that's kind of the direction of this application, where we're going.
My answer is yes, and most of the document is public. There are components of it that the developer can identify as not being public that are confidential, proprietary, or financial information, but by and large, most of it will be public.
Will be public, okay.
And I think, and I can't find the exact section, but you do have the ability to request more information and, you know, that kind of thing throughout here, I believe. I know in the designation process, there's a section in there about any further studies can be required, that type of thing.
Okay.
But yeah, this is meant to be a starting point. I agree with Corey 100%.
Well, I guess we could beef it up. Page 5, in the middle of the page, we have additional required information. And then we talk about the increment calculations, letter of intent from potential tenants, market feasibility reports. We could just add another bullet and others as requested by the board or something.
Certainly.
If you want.
You want to say that again?
I said, and others requested by the board, but we could certainly change that language.
Other information.
How about additional? Okay.
The only other comment I had about it is we have kind of inconsistent formatting, spacing, and sentences that I think
clean it up. Okay,
could be cleaned up. Looks like places where we've had a short sentence, and or looks like somebody hit the.
That's a result of cutting and pasting a lot of different things. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it looks a lot better in the non-redline version. You know, if you don't look at the red line, you look at the other part of it.
Well,
it looks
better. Yeah, yeah, that's the one that I wanted to read that makes sure it made sense.
Red lines tend to move things around. I don't want to.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, do I have a motion to approve the development proposal applications with the addition? On page 5 of adding a bullet stating and other information requested by the board for LaDonna, as well as cleaning up the formatting.
I so move.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any other discussion on the motion? Okay, any objection? Okay, motion passes to approve the development proposal application.
All right.
There you go, Jim.
I don't have to good. Make more changes?
Yeah, you do.
Wait a minute.
The ones we talked about.
Don't we want to drag him through a few more?
Really?
Why not?
Yeah.
Okay, on to the next item, guys. Funding request form. confidential financial statement form.
Okay, the major changes to this one are really on the first page, and a couple things on the second as well. But the first page, and this, thank you, LaDonna, for your edits on this. This came straight from her. So you can see under the note there, we don't use the term certified. We've changed it to current audited. Again, we've got rid of some of the terms that are not quite current any longer, from what I understand. So, and then we ask them to attach the financial statements of any related entities, investors, or others that are necessary to provide a complete understanding of the financial condition. Oh, and on above, I should make this point, where it says applicant, we wanted a definition of who the applicant was. So I added the applicant is defined as the developer, project sponsor, or the owner.
We're expecting that they probably won't.
So.
That came from the original.
Really, are there any, and I'm just taking any questions, really, because.
There are a few things that I had, that we still didn't get in here, and one is that applicant. I think that at the end, or owner, it should be and slash or owner, because we may want from multiple people.
Section was that,
or
page?
Oh, right at the beginning, underneath the applicant, there's an asterisk.
We'll do an and slash owner, and slash or.
And or, and slash or. And then on that, also on page one, it says note attached to this statement is a current audited financial statement. So it either needs to say attach a current audited financial statement or attached to this statement is a current audited financial statement.
That's what
so
it says.
So is needs to come out.
That's what it says.
Attached to this statement.
It says attached to this statement is a current audited financial statement. Not good grammar. You would say attached is a current, or an instruction to someone to attach a financial statement. I think is needs to come out. Number four is just a formatting.
Wait, back up.
Because
I don't get it.
It's either telling someone to attach it, say attached to the statement, a current, or them stating attached is a statement. Yeah, okay, I see.
So just strike the word is in the note.
But I think since it's we're instructing them to attach it, right?
Got it.
Good. Page two is just a formatting. Number four needs to be out to the margin. Page four. The certification, it says we certify that this confidential statement of financial capability, that is not the terminology that we use, and maybe that's a better title for this document. We call the document confidential financial statement.
So you would just change.
So maybe state, I don't know, that's a question. Is statement of financial capability a better.
Clarify it.
Description of what this is?
I really don't care what we call it.
Confidential statement of financial ability.
Capability.
She's just saying the title of the document.
She just wants to change the title to statement of financial capability.
They just need to be in agreement. Right. I don't feel real strongly.
Up to you guys.
Which way they need to be, but.
But they ought to be the same, is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Instead of toggling back and forth. So.
So which way do you want it?
Confidential financial statement. I mean, that's. Why don't we just keep it at that and take it all the way through?
Okay. So on four, it just needs to be.
So we'll just change that on four. Okay.
I'd make a motion that we approve the confidential financial statement as with the changes recommended tonight.
A second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion on the motion? Any objection? Okay, motion passes to approve the confidential financial statement form. Did you want to go through the amendment to lift bylaws? As you know, we had just a few revisions, but we did take action and approve that in our last.
Yeah, this is just information only. You don't have to take any action, but I wanted to make sure everybody had the final copy. The main change was section two, where we had a conflict there between the last two sentences with the one said 25,000, the other said 5,000. So we changed them both to 25,000. That was it.
Okay. Is there any questions on that, guys? No? Okay, moving on to new business. And the first item is the executive director's contract. And so kind of a maybe a larger discussion that we can have on this is just pertaining to, you know, contracts as a whole, and what we're looking at with Lyft and our budget, really, reflection and as we move forward. So I think as we review, Jim, your contract, as well as kind of all of our contract hires, I think we need to be very cognizant on this board of our current budget and where we're heading and what our income stream looks like, you know, the money coming in and the money going out. So tonight, you know, I recommend we kind of look a little bit at, Jim, your contract as it pertains to, you know, the near-term goals of the board here and what kind of things look like as we move forward in the future. And, you know, the feasibility of how we're going to continue on a day-to-day is something I think we can get into the weeds with when we start talking about our goals and those types of things. But I think in the near term, we need to make sure we're insulating ourselves and, you know, for the potential to get projects in. But until we get there, we need to streamline ourselves on what we have today from a budgetary standpoint to make sure we're in alignment with the goals with the city and the community and making sure we're, you know, not behind the eight ball here with some of those items. So projecting there back on this item on Jim's contract at hand, I have some recommendations on this contract and how we can potentially begin to maybe cater that more to the budgetary standpoint that we're talking about. And that might be a little bit more near term as it is an hourly contract, Jim. I think maybe understanding more on a weekly basis what tasks are so we know where things are going. And there's also another component where city staff, we've been able to allocate now some city staff to absorb some of our admin and more day-to-day and things. Now, we did have a conversation, Jim, about, and Corey, about what that actually looks like, your duties, and where do we start to actually say, okay, here are Jim's five duties out of the 20, you know, how can we absorb 15 of them into staff, and what does that look like? So I think there's a next step in a detailed discussion about what that looks like in our moving forward. But I think in the near term, you know, obviously we need to work through your contract, and I do have some quick comments that maybe we can discuss here tonight. But to be specific on staff and what is available to us, in discussions with the city staff, we have some availability on the economic development staff. And again, this is kind of just coming off the press, so we've got to understand who that is exactly and how many hours are committed. And I think that helps us get this figured out more. And I think this also extracts to how much tech support we're going to need on a monthly basis until we get some projects and some revenue coming in, how much, you know, we're able to bear. And then also, you know, I think we maintain our monthly meetings that we have, but, you know, maybe we have the opportunity to, you know, cater our meetings around deals as they come in and development potentials. And so if we need a meeting 1 month, we'll have it on the, you know, we'll get the agendas pulled up and get the notices out and move from there. If we're not needed to the full capacity of our board every month, then, you know, we don't need to be there at that extent. So I wanted to reiterate that to the group here. And if there's any comments on that, but going back to kind of the item here on the director's report, or I'm sorry, on the executive report in contract here for Jim, if you guys look at kind of the first item there, you know, some of my comments would be maybe kind of limiting some things to just weekly understanding of hours, and, you know, maybe there's a level of effort there in that first paragraph that we talk about, adding that there would be a, you know, projected tasks and hours on a weekly basis, so we know what we're doing for that week and that month as we move forward, and that could be an approval process, so we know kind of what our financials are going to be for that month.
What has been the process so far? Are you submitting an invoice that's detailed as to what days and time and that kind of
information? Yeah. So what I basically do is I go through every time that I, you know, put hours in, I list the task that was accomplished and how many hours and the rate, that whole bit. So every time that,
and that Justin signs that. By
that's the, monthly, the, yes. But okay. So what I'm saying is maybe there's some, it's more of a precursor to some of the task projections. Just saying, hey, you know, here's what we're looking like. And I know I'm in the same boat with, you know, other projects I work on in my business is projecting, you know, plus or minus a few hours here and there. But just understanding what that cost is going to look like that month. That, and I know it all relates back to some of the detailed tasks that we need to work through. But this is just a general comment that I'm presenting on that first paragraph to put in. And then secondly, in a term, you know, on an hourly, not to exceed, do we need a term basis? That's maybe a question, you know, Corey, is that something that's required and needed? And that's just kind of a housekeeping question that I have on that one.
You don't need a term, but ultimately there's going to be an amount that is budgeted and appropriated for that, for either the position or consultants. And so you need to fall within on an annual basis whatever is appropriated in your budget.
Okay, so it's an hourly, it's basically a not to exceed number that we appropriate into our budget, which we have for $36,000, and then we adapt it to that.
It's exactly the way our legal services contract reads. There's no term on that.
Okay.
It just gives you an hourly rate and the type of tasks that Corey does.
Okay, good. And I mean, again,
I'd be happy to take that out of there.
So. Yeah, good.
Well, I mean, I think there is a notification requirement because, you know, did we have it? I forget what it was, but there's a 30 days or something like that.
Yeah, section 5.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, obviously this is boilerplate written into city contract, and there's some other items in here. Maybe going to the third paragraph under compensation. Question is, travel time will be compensated at half the hourly rate above. So is that, so the city pays for travel time and mileage? Is that the standard process through contract, or how does that?
Again, right now, the way the contract I had last year read was basically mileage.
Okay.
Paid the government rate. What I'm suggesting here is that we go to half hourly time, because again, modeling it after Corey's contract, that's what they do, is basically charge half time for it, but no mileage.
Okay.
It's a little easier.
Just moving down the line here, and I think, I don't know, we're missing a paragraph 4. I don't, were you guys missing one? Or maybe it was struck.
4, yeah.
Under termination, you know, typically in contracts I see, it's always a 2-week, you know, it's not a 30-day, it's a 14-day lead time, and I don't know if that varies in everybody's contract or if that's boilerplate, but there's always a, you know, a 2-week notice time frame in there. So that's another thing that I noticed in the contract that I'd like to highlight. And then I, you know, the other items are pretty straightforward that I see, Jim, and maybe getting to your exhibit A on sheet 6 here. And so these are the items of discussion of, you know, how much can the city bear from a staff level now when we don't have a project. And then what that looks like when, you know, on the executive level, we absorb that work into that. You know, I think that that's something that we need to go through maybe more specifically. But I just see kind of that first urban renewal area planning and approval section. You know, that is definitely kind of under the executive side of things. It's more day-to-day. It's coming to the board meetings. It's our interaction from how I see it. Some of it on the upfront might have been a little bit heavy, the first 3 bullet points on what's been done in the past as part of the URA process, but I think most of this is pretty, you know, in your wheelhouse from an executive director's level. And then kind of on the next page here on 7, you know, I think this is where things start to get a little gray as to what maybe could disperse among staff at the city on the management and then into the administrative duties. I think those are some things we could start talking about that that would be helpful to reduce some of our burdens here on a budgetary standpoint. So, you know, maybe just to summarize, I think it would be prudent to have a next conversation with staff and understand what that looks like before I can't dictate anything without having that conversation yet collectively, and then we can bring it back in front of everybody to discuss. But I do understand that, you know, on the interim, getting everybody's input on this contract would be helpful so Jim can kind of move forward in his capacity, you know, in what we're doing right now. So does anybody have any comments or questions related to this contract?
I have a question on page 7, the top, the first bullet, develop design guidelines and or zoning changes with landowners and developers for approval by the renewal board. Is that typical that you would be involved in design guidelines and zoning? Seems like that should be the landowner or the developer.
Actually, you know, these were part of last year's contract, and since that time, since we adopted the urban renewal plans, I think the plans were, you know, decided that the LIFT board would not play that big a role in those type of things, that we would defer to planning board and planning staff. So if we want to strike that bullet, but I think, you know, in terms of things like design guidelines and that type of thing, I think this board would want to have some input onto that. Certainly something we could discuss maybe through our work session, whether or not you want to do that or not. But as far as zone changes and that type of thing, I'm not sure we would be playing as big a role.
Well, my experience as a city has pretty strong design guidelines and for most areas, and if they don't have it for an area, they're pretty much usually ready to develop those guidelines before they get too far into a project. So I think we could just remove that.
Yeah, I think, point. Again, that goes back to what I was speaking about earlier on the, you know, our role is not, that's more on the planning board and their filters of design guidelines and site planning and some of those specifics, but there is a little bit of overlap there, but I think anything related to that, yeah, I mean, I think it's going to go into their wheelhouse on that review process. And even though, you know, I do a lot of planning myself, so I don't, I want to dabble in that, but it's
well, yeah, you know, I don't want to digress too far from this, but it's a conversation that I think the board needs to have as to how much influence you think you should have on what a plan or architecturally or what something looks like. You know, you are agreeing to provide a lot of money to help out a project. It's your call, really, if you, you know, want to insert yourself in there in some fashion or not.
Wouldn't the board want to have final approval opportunity if it's a multi-phase PUD type of development that has design guidelines rather than a specific design, and those guidelines would provide input to multiple projects over a long period of time? I think the board would want to see those guidelines and approve them after they've been negotiated with the planning commission or city staff.
And I would again, before I can't answer that because I don't know the protocol of approvals with the city. I can't speak to that. So I agree. I think listening and hearing about those, but approvals on that level, Corey, do you have any?
Typically, in my experience, urban renewal authorities don't approve design guidelines. But where design guidelines may be extremely significant is one common eligible improvement is if you have a finish that is a lower grade finish on a facade, for example, and someone wants to bring a higher grade that brings up the entire area, that may be an eligible improvement. And it's hard to differentiate that from a design guideline in some cases, because you're talking about a certain finish that actually the authority may decide to contribute as an eligible improvement to bring the entire area up. So it's not a design guideline improvement, but it is certainly looking at finishes and perhaps contributing public dollars to those if it determines that they remediate blight.
Again, I think it's a subject for a work session because, frankly, what I was talking about here was applying to a whole URA, not specific projects, not like, you know, a retail center, and we have design guidelines for that retail center, and we have different ones for the bank down the street. That's not what I'm talking about, the entire URA. But again, I think it's a discussion for another day.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of items on there that are a discussion that maybe we can, you know, shelve and put into a work session collectively. But I think it's also twofold. It's that for, you know, with the board and where we're going, and then Jim, kind of what your role is and how much of that, you know, influences us and how much we need, you know, here around this table and how much staff can support us. So,
and at the risk of speaking a little bit out of school, I mean, I think that we just learned literally this week that the city is willing to contribute more staff resources to Lyft. And I think we still need to understand what that means. And so it's really difficult to have the conversation about even the scope without knowing what the city's going to backfill. And so, I think Justin has indicated the possibility of getting input, but ultimately we also need to circle back with the city and find out what its intention is in terms of staffing, and then we can bring that back, I think.
So from a protocol standpoint, you know, I can reach out to the city, and as far as have that conversation, what kind of format does that look like? Can we have the conversation and then we bring that to the board, let's say in our next meeting, put it on the agenda and have that conversation on those levels? Or can we have anything in the interim between today and our May 7th meeting that we can flesh out so we can kind of understand contract and some other things?
I would say both. If we're able to have a meeting with the city and determine what the Economic Development Department's backfill role is going to be and what staffing they can provide, we can certainly send correspondence out to the Lyft board. I'll use it as an opportunity to caution that it's a one-way communication, that we don't want to use reply to all on emails and create an inadvertent electronic meeting. And so I always recommend that we may send communications out to you via email, but reply to all arguably creates a meeting. But I do think it is an opportunity for us to send communication out, and you'll have that, and it'll be a work in progress up to the next meeting.
Okay.
So as a suggestion, that if we took the scope of services from the back, the outline, and submitted that to, if it's the economic development staff or if it's Michael Penny, I don't know, and start with that and see what they can provide. You know, just FYI, I mean, as far as my thoughts on this are concerned, since Jim Taylor left and Terry did too, I've been doing a lot of administrative type things, which I would love to have somebody else do, quite frankly. I mean, it's work that I'm probably not as good at as somebody else would be, as far as that is concerned, and it's also costing you money.
Right. And I think this goes back to this work session and what's Lyft doing this year, and what do we do when we get a project, and how do we adapt to that? So, and I think that, you know, your contract and bringing that up in a renewal period really kind of resurfaces all of those items as to what, you know, what we need to do moving forward and to make sure we do it appropriately and under budget. So what I could do is if there are other comments, you know, please put some comments down on the contract. I'll distribute to you my comments on this contract, and then get a meeting discussion set up with staff, city staff, and then we can, you know, get items put on the next meeting agenda. If not, have something done sooner so we can kind of move appropriately.
So in the meantime, since I don't have a contract, I suggest I can just continue to work hourly.
And yes, I mean, as far as contractually, I think we could date this back to, you know, the 31st, basically, and you know, build to the contract that we are negotiating and working towards. So yes.
And you could certainly make a motion tonight to authorize him to work on an hourly basis until the contract is finalized at the direction of the chairman, so that there is, consistent with what you've talked about, kind of the weekly oversight in the interim, and then there's no question that the work he's doing during that timeframe is authorized.
Okay. Good. Well, why don't we do that?
I'll move on that.
Okay.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion on the motion?
As concerns the permanent contract, if the city is stepping in with volunteering to do more work, seems the whole contract should be submitted to the city, not only the work items. So I'd be interested in seeing the city's degree of involvement in total.
I agree.
So, anyhow, that's the discussion part of the motion.
Okay. Thank you. Any other discussion on that, guys? Okay. Any objection to the motion? Okay. Motion passes. Let's see. We've been talking about a lot, the Lyft work session, topics and date, and I handed out, Jim put together a nice little breakout here in bullet point of, you know, some potential topics, and I know that Ann Ricker mentioned a few months back that she would want to facilitate, and she would do that for free. That's what I kept hearing.
I kind of remember free, don't you remember?
So, that's on record here,
I thought,
right?
You said pro bono. I thought pro bono came up a couple times.
No, but I think...
we can check the video.
Yeah. I think that was pre-video, I think.
Okay. So. How convenient.
Some tapes. But
I've tried to reach out to Anne. As you know, she's not exactly timely at getting back to me.
Well, I think that brings up the point of, you know, whether or not we put something a few months out and actually just establish a date. And like we talked about, maybe it is, maybe we can have a work session before or after a set time. And as we mentioned, if we have agenda items that we want to continue with this board meeting every month, or if we don't, maybe it could be one of those time frames that we just break it into a study session during that time frame that we're all kind of we've kind of blocked out in our schedules. So maybe we can look at doing something like that. Maybe it's not the May meeting, but maybe we push for June, and we could see if we can get Ann and get some alignment there with some of our goals. And
I'd recommend that we set aside a special time to do that, so we don't have other business to discuss that day. You know, you're going to burn through some time real quickly just going through these topics, and it would be great to get your full attention on it.
Okay. Anybody have any recommendations on that? What you'd like to see?
I agree with Jim that it should be a separate session. There's an awful lot of time on these.
And this was my suggestion, by the way. You feel free to... you know, cut some topics out of here that you don't want, or add others. I just, you know, I've done these kind of things before in the past, and, you know, every board needs to have a mission statement, goals, objectives, that type of thing, and you want to know how you're going to go about implementing plans, and is the board going to take a more proactive role, or as we are right now, kind of waiting and seeing how developers come in with proposals. So that's a whole discussion in itself. And then, you know, we just touched upon this last thing, the sustainability issues, you know, how are you going to keep this organization afloat? So those are kind of my main bullet points. You want to talk about TIF, you know, how's used. I mean, different URAs interpret how TIF money is spent differently, you know, as far as what they'll put the TIF money into. So we want to talk about that, because that would help me out greatly. Some will put money into facade treatments on buildings, some will not, you know, and they draw the line at the surface, and that's about it. So something we need to talk about. And then community outreach, you know, how much of that do you want to do? How involved do you want to get with, you know, different organizations within the city, and getting to lift kind of what you guys do out there? I certainly think it's a huge economic development tool, and, you know, certain organizations that are in charge of that need to know that.
Corey, if we, so a workshop meeting, so that is a meeting.
It is.
And so we would have the the broadcast of it. It's just a meeting.
Yes.
Even if we have it at some strange time, it's just...
That is correct.
The whole deal.
And we have to notice it and post it. And
public and
you
all
may not
that.
Need, you don't have to have it here. You can have it somewhere else if you want to.
Have it in your living room, Gary.
Yeah. With our TV system there that... Yeah.
Well, and that's why, you know, having... I don't know if this is a one-and-a-half-hour, three-hour, you know, meeting, but, you know, if we had it coincide with... whether it's an earlier time, let's say 5:30 or 6 o'clock, and we go to 9 o'clock, you know. And if we do have items, though, that month, you know, on that agenda, on that set date, maybe, you know, it's not the right time, but I think we can adapt. You know, I'm looking forward at the May 7th. We obviously are pretty booked up. We're going to have presentations, things like that. But I don't see too much going on to that meeting yet on the agenda, but, you know, life happens. So, I mean, tonight we can set a date or we can try to coincide a date with what we already have set up, you know, the meeting room, the time, and that type of thing.
I think this is more than an hour and a half meeting. I think it'll be...
Yeah, so let's say it's a three-hour meeting.
Hours.
Yeah.
I'd say it's probably at least four. But
yeah, I would say...
Let's just go for six. Let's just do a date.
Oh, it's easily... This outline... It's a couple of days, actually. Is what
well, maybe we break it into two. I mean, yeah. You know, we don't have to jam everything into, you know, one moment in time. I mean, maybe we break it up and we have two jam sessions and go from there. So we're not kind of...
You do that?
Yeah.
...burying ourselves in one day. Okay. Well, I mean, as far as dates and times, we probably want to do it... maybe we could look at something... after the May 7th, since we've already moved that up, and it's three or so weeks from now. But maybe we could look at breaking it up into two segments, maybe between our May and June meeting, and then maybe, or maybe we can jam them into between the May and June. I'd recommend we do that, if we want to kind of start moving this along. Anybody have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, it depends on Mr. Collins' vacation schedule, I think.
Yeah,
I
mean,
I'm sitting here thinking exactly that.
That's why we broke it into two. We're going to.
It was actually the 14th that I left open. Was you guys moved it around?
Well, you know.
But the whole latter part of the month, I'm going to be gone again. So.
Okay.
I'm going to be out of.
Starting the 17th.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I'm going to be out of town for some graduations. And
well, let's do this because we can sit here and talk schedules. I mean, let's either send a doodle or a kind of scheduling out and see who's available. And then since we have so many parties here, we don't need to, you know, talk through that. And then we'll figure out a date.
If we're going to have Ann do this, we probably should start with when she's available.
Exactly. And Jim's laughing because it sounds like she's not available.
No. LaDonna could recount last year.
Well, if I put together a quick doodle, just a calendar kind of availability, and we shot it to her, I mean,
yes.
We could put enough dates in there that everybody's available and we feel pretty good about it, and we can go from there. But I think a conversation with her prior to that about fee and the free part would be a good thing, too.
I think we'll start with the free part.
Okay. All right, well, I'll take that on. I'll send that out to everybody. We can get this thing scheduled up and move forward there. Any other new business?
No.
Okay, executive session. You don't have anything on those?
I don't have anything for executive session.
Other, anything else that anybody would like to speak on tonight?
I have a couple of things.
Sure.
I want to, and maybe this is a question for Andrea?
Angela,
I'm sorry. We have had complaints in the past about not being responsive to citizens' telephone calls, emails, etc. And I'm not sure how much you handle and how much Jim may handle, but can you kind of explain the process to us or how that works?
Steal your mic. Thanks. Yep, and I just started this week on it, but Matt gave me the email addresses for Lyft, where everything that comes to Lyft will now come to me. So anything that comes to that general Lyft address on email will come to me.
And then one of my colleagues, Anya, she handles the hotline. So I know there was one discrepancy last month, and that was when she was out of town for a couple of days. But from now on, we'll have backup for that. And we do have someone who will always be monitoring that.
So what is it? What is your intention as far as responding to information requests or just questions? I mean, is it basically go to you, you refer it to Jim, or how does that work?
Typically, we'll answer what we can, and if it's something a little bit more where we need more developed response, then we'll go to Jim if it's more in depth.
Yeah, so usually we have like, they have like this spreadsheet, grid, whatever, that they fill in what the question is, who it was, the phone number, and, you know, the essence of the call. And then if it's something they can't answer, then I will call it back, and I'll fill in the boxes and send it back to them.
And then they return the call?
No. I would return the call myself, yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay. I just want to make sure that we're kind of staying on top of that and responding to people
who
have questions. The only other thing, we've talked about the board members getting updated plans, because all of our plans are not...
We will.
What? They're not correct?
They're still in flux. I mean, because of what of council... Well, let me back up. The Broadway plan and the Littleton Boulevard plans are finished, and we should be able to do that, and I'm going to get Ann to do a final set of those two. The Columbine plan and the Santa Fe plan, the legal descriptions are still not quite there yet. So when they are, I think we'll be updating the notebooks.
Okay.
And for you three, you haven't seen these. There are actually these notebooks that are like this thick, and we'll get them updated.
And also the website will then, we will then upload those revised maps. And okay.
That's all I have.
My comment that I was going to ask Angela, kind of in line with the telephone, but also to that community outreach piece of the workshop. Do you guys, who manages the social media? Do you guys do that? Do you have a kind of calendar of how things go with that? Or what's, tell me about that.
That I'll have to check on. Like I said, I just started 2 days ago, but I can check and get back to you on that. I know that we typically have a calendar for all of our social media, so I'm positive there's one in place. I'm just not sure of the exact.
Yeah, I followed Lyft on Twitter, and nobody followed me back, so I'm...
No, there's been no activity since February. So.
Okay.
I don't know what that says, but...
About you or about Lyft?
I don't know. No, just kidding. But so you'll check on that.
I will.
Everything
Facebook
down the line,
Twitter.
You bring up a good point. Facebook. I mean, I don't think we have a Facebook account or anything, but I know we do have Twitter and other kind of social media outlet and announcements and things like that. That's great.
Right. I'll check on that.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah. I mean, there is. I see Twitter and Facebook on the website, but it's.
Let me know if you get followed back on that.
I'll check.
You can just follow Jason, that's all. You
know, follow Jason.
I mean, Justin, rather. Follow Justin. Yeah.
Oh, no.
This probably isn't the time for someone to explain to me what Twitter is it?
Yeah. That'll be post meeting. We'll talk about it more.
Don't embarrass yourself.
Okay, anything else?
I just had one other thing. Corey already said it. Don't reply to all. Ever. So they'll be like, can you attend on June 6th? Just reply back.
It seems like a courtesy, but it's not.
Don't do it. Yeah. So
duly noted.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Meeting's adjourned.
Okay.
Thank you.
You can do a doodle. You can do a doodle poll, right?
Yeah, they're all doing it individually.
Yeah, they're doing it separately.